This is the show dedicated to raising up the next generation of men of faith and character. My name is Mark Stanifer. Welcome to the Next Men Up. Hey guys, welcome back to the Next Men Up podcast and the show that is dedicated to raising up the next generation of men. Because when boys become healthy and godly men, everyone benefits. My name is Mark Stanifer. So good to be with you as always. Today, I'm joined by Blake Brewer. Blake is a husband. He's a father of three. His most recent is just a few weeks old. And he's on a crazy big mission to help 1 million dads to connect better with their kids, specifically through writing a letter. This all came about through a crazy story that Blake shares with you here on today's episode about a tragedy that became the defining moment in his life and changed the course of his life forever. It's a compelling and powerful story that you don't want to miss, and it's led to the work that he is doing today through this Legacy Letter Challenge, which invites dads to use the power of the written word to write a letter to their kids that will leave a lasting legacy. So I'm excited to share this story with you as Blake tells of his experience and the difference that it's made in his life and now the work that he's doing to help fathers connect with their sons. So let's get right to it. Here's our conversation with Blake Brewer. So Blake, what a privilege to have you on the show. I'm looking forward to our conversation today, man. Thank you for joining us.
Mark, I'm so excited to be here. I've been looking forward to this time all week. I absolutely love what you are about and what Next Man Up is about. And so I'm just grateful to be here and talk to you today.
Well, I think our audience is really going to benefit from your story. And I want to get into that because it's pretty crazy. And I love when God does these things in our lives, redeems our experiences and our story. But before we do that, dude, big congrats are in order for the new addition to your family. He's what, like 2-3 weeks old now?
Yeah, we got about a 2-week old. My third child, Brooks, was born. And man, kudos to my wife. My wife gives birth to like humongous babies, like they're basically toddlers when they come out. My daughter, who's 4 and a half, she was 9 pounds, 12 ounces, and we thought that was huge. But then my next child, my son, Bo, he was 11 pounds, 3 ounces, 24 inches long. And we were like, what in the world? My wife actually got mad at me, Mark. She was like, this is all your fault. I was like, what did I do? I was 10'8" when I was born. So she said, this is your genes. This is your fault. But by God's grace, she said, okay, we can go for a third. But this time she was like, I can't go full term. So we took him out 10 days early.
Okay.
He was still 9-12.
Wow.
And so he was headed towards 11. So it was a good thing. Good thing we went ahead and did that.
That was a good call. That's a good woman to be able to give birth to three big babies like that. Good for her.
Well, now she said she was done, but you know how God works, man.
He
somehow allows you to forget those horrible moments of the pregnancy. And so I could see us maybe having a fourth. We'll see.
Or some of those challenging moments of when they're first born and the infant days and the sleepless nights and all that. At least that was my experience.
Oh, yeah. Well, lucky for us, this baby's pretty good and I'm getting good sleep. I don't know if my wife's getting like the best sleep, but I'm getting good sleep.
Well, good for you. And congratulations again to you and your family. Three kids now. And that's a cool thing. So I wanted to make sure we acknowledge that because I know it's a big development in your family.
Well, yeah, I appreciate it. And man, I got to tell you, I have absolutely embraced being a father and it is like the best thing ever, man. Mm-hmm. I just love being with my kids. I get so much joy and just wrestling with them and having fun and dancing with my daughter. And we're having a blast over here.
Good for you. As someone who's got kids that are on their way out and the empty nest chapter is right in front of us, I can tell you this with certainty. While the days are long, the years are short and it goes by so fast. So embrace it, engage with it, and enjoy it to the maximum, because it won't be long and you'll be looking back saying, like I do, where in the world did time go?
Well, that's what everybody tells me. So I'm trying to do everything I can to capture every moment, enjoy every moment. So I'm right there with you. I agree with you, Mark.
Yeah, good on you. So you mentioned father, and when we have guests on the show, I always like to ask them what their relationship was like with their father. So this is a question that is a common question I'll pose to guests. But with you, it has, as we unpack your story, it has more significance maybe than for others. So I wonder if you could just take a few minutes and talk about what it was like growing up and the relationship you had with your dad. And then as we unpack this, it'll be clear as to why this question is so important.
Well, I absolutely love my dad. He was the hero in my life. I would say when I look at my younger years, like 12 and younger, my dad was really involved, and we, you know, wrestled, we had fun. He was my football coach. He was my baseball coach. I have some great memories of my dad every night coming into my bed, and my sister would join us, and he would pray with us each night. Mm. Which was pretty neat. Now, I found out later that it was my mom who was the one who said, "Hey, Larry, I think you should be going to pray with our kids." And so, of course, behind great dads, a lot of times there's a great mom.
Oh, absolutely.
And then I couldn't have said this at the time, but looking back, and especially now that I'm a father, I realized, you know, I did not have the perfect father, because nobody does.
That's right.
But I don't think my dad connected with me in junior high and high school like he could have. And I've talked about this with my mom. But, you know, I don't know what it was. I think, you know, I was also trying to like go hang out with my friends and do all that stuff. But I think he could have done better there. But then there was one thing, you know, I'm going to share with you the story of my dad passing. But when I was 19, and there was something that he did there that absolutely changed my life. And I'm going to share with you guys. And I'm grateful for what he did on that day.
Yeah. So let's get into that, because it's such a huge part of your story and who you've become. And I think it won't necessarily answer the question why there wasn't that connection there, but it will provide an opportunity for dads that are listening to have a tool in place or an idea of how they can bridge those teenage years, because they're tough, man. They're tough. I've walked through it with my own boys and now with my daughter. And sometimes it can feel like, how do I connect with this alien, you know, this other human being that's not the same kid. Anyway, I'm co-opting the conversation here. Really, what I want to get to is, tell us about what happened at 19 years old.
Well, at 19, it was May 23rd, 2003, and it was definitely the worst day of my life. And I hope what I went through that day, that nobody else has to go through this. My mom had planned a vacation for my family, and we went to Hawaii, and we had gone to Florida before, we'd gone to Colorado, but this was like the pinnacle vacation.
Yeah.
And so we were so excited to go. I had just finished my freshman year at college. I had just got home, and we hopped on a plane, went to Hawaii. And I never forget the first day that we were there, and it was that morning, and we were trying to decide, we're looking at all the brochures, we're in the kitchen of our condo, and we're trying to decide what we're going to go do. And my dad, who was not really a funny guy, just made us laugh out loud, because we looked at this brochure of riding a moped, and he started to mock himself riding a moped. And the reason that this was so funny is because he was a really large guy. He was 6'3", 230. My dad was a college football player, got drafted by the Falcons. He was actually Terry Bradshaw's tight end at Louisiana Tech, and caught Bradshaw's first touchdown pass. So it was just really funny to imagine my dad riding a moped. And yeah. we all laughed and we said, okay, we're not going to go do mopeds, but we're going to go to the beach and go snorkeling. And we love snorkeling and swimming. And we went to a place called Hanama Bay. And if you've ever been to Hawaii, you know this is one of the most beautiful places in the world to go snorkeling. It's just so pretty. And so as soon as we get to the beach, we jump in the water and my dad and I are out in the water looking at some of the most beautiful sea life. I remember a sea turtle went by. And Mark, I just remember thinking, how awesome is this? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm just getting to hang out with my dad.
Yep.
And I had been gone at college for a year. And so just to come back, and it was just kind of this surreal experience. And my dad and I just kept going further and further out. And next thing I know, the water has become a little more treacherous and the waves have picked up. And now I know that we are in a place called Witch's Brew, which is really known for the treacherous water. And so I lift my head out of the water and I'm like, where did my dad go? And I see my dad a little ways away trying to get out of the water and climb out on this rock. And I remember thinking, why is he trying to get out right there? Because the waves are just crashing against this rock. And so I knew something was up for him to even be trying to get out of the water. And sure enough, one of those waves comes as he's about halfway out of the water and just hits him and knocks him back down in the water. And I remember thinking, okay, so now, you know, my dad's probably in trouble. I got to swim over there and see how he's doing. And I remember swimming towards my dad and I remember him yelling for help. And the reason I remember this so vividly is because my dad had this deep booming voice and this yell for help was more like a whimper. Mm. And I could just tell his energy was not there. And so I continued to swim towards him. And again, the waves are just so big. So it's not just like smooth water where I can see exactly where he is. It's like a wave would come and I'd get to the top of the wave and I'd say, okay, there he is. And I'd keep swimming. And when I got to my dad was under the water and he was unconscious. And now at this point I'm thinking, okay, this is really serious. And I knew that he had just gone under because I had just seen him above the water. And so I put my arms around him and I just started swimming with my dad. I did all that I knew to do. I tried to keep my dad's head above water. And I started swimming. The beach part wasn't very close. I had to get around to the other side of that rock. And by God's grace, another snorkeler in the area had seen us and seen me struggling with my dad and showed up. I don't know where this guy came from, but I'm so grateful that he did because I needed some relief and I needed to go in. And looking back, I don't think I would have ever left my dad. And so I would have just kept trying. And so I get to shore. At that point, I do see the lifeguard going out to my dad. He's got a surfboard. They get my dad on the surfboard, bring him into shore. And they start doing CPR to my dad. And I remember getting on a knee next to my dad and just literally begging God for my dad's life. God, please let my dad live. And just like in the movies where you see someone that's been underneath the water and they're doing CPR and you see the water just kind of come out of their mouth, gurgle out of their mouth, they start coughing and they come to. I knew that just at any moment, like surely this is about, that's what's about to happen right here. My mom and sister were laying out on the beach and they saw all the commotion going on and they said, that's where Dad and Blake were. So they run down to the beach and I'll never forget my mom running up to me and she had a distressed look on her face. Of course, she sees my dad on the beach right next to me. They're doing CPR. And I just told her, I was like, Mom, this is not good. I don't think Dad's going to make it. And they loaded my dad up in the ambulance. They took him to the hospital where they pronounced my dad dead. And I remember going to the hospital after that and just walking into the hospital room and just looking at my dad. And he still had his swimsuit on, no shirt, of course. And he just looked asleep, and it was still, I just knew at some point, like surely he's just going to wake up. Right. Like, we literally were just having one of the best days of my life. In a matter of moments, my dad is gone and had breathed his last breath. And it was a horrible day, a horrible time. We had to go back to the hotel room, and it literally felt like we were in a different country because we were so far away from home and family and friends. And I had to start, I was the oldest, I am the oldest. My mom was in no condition to start calling people. So I was the one who had to start calling back and wow. letting my dad's parents know, my dad's brother, his work, and just repeating this story that was so fresh in my mind. It just happened. I still couldn't even believe what was going on. And that afternoon I was on the bed, and I was mourning and weeping. And my mom comes into the room. And what happens next is just unbelievable. It's totally of God. But my mom says, I got something out of your dad's suitcase, and it's for you. Your dad has been working on a letter for the last couple months, and he just finished it before the trip, and he was going to give it to you on this trip. It's a letter for you and your sister and brother. Here's your copy. And so I'm reading this letter. My dad had not ever written us a letter before. My dad did not know that he was about to die. And I'm reading what would basically be my dad's last words to me. And this letter was a big letter of encouragement. And my dad encouraged me to persevere. My dad in life, that I was going to face trials. My dad encouraged me to have courage. My dad encouraged me to have an eternal perspective. My dad encouraged me to read the Bible and to know the scriptures for myself. He said, preachers and teachers and evangelists are great, but you need to know the Bible for yourself. And then the last line of this letter, and I'll never forget it, and I'll never forget any of the letter, but this last line just sticks with me. My dad said, here on earth, you might be in the minority for your faith, but I assure you that in heaven, you'll be in the majority. Hmm. Love your dear old dad in Christ Jesus. How does my dad have the ability or the wherewithal to write that sentence and to write this letter? And the only thing I can think is that God allowed my dad to write this letter because it was exactly what I needed that day. And that letter just gave me a peace about the whole situation. Not that I didn't miss my dad any less. I mourned and went through the grieving process the entire next year. But I knew that my dad was in heaven. And I began to say, you know, even if God gave the option to my dad, hey, do you want to go back down to earth? My dad would say, heck no.
Yeah.
I think I'll just stay right here and I'll wait on them up here. And I began to have an attitude of gratitude that I had a great dad for 19 years of my life when so many people don't know their dad or don't have a great dad. But I did have a dad. I can be thankful for that. And, you know, nowhere does God promise us that we're going to live to be 70, 89 years old. My dad lived to, he was 54, and I can be grateful for the life that he had in the years that I had him. And so that next year, you know, as I was experiencing this pain and this trauma, I just looked back and realized, man, I could have tried to escape that pain by drugs, alcohol, the normal things that people use to escape pain. But I actually did the opposite. I grew and developed more as a person and in my relationship with God. I leaned in on him and friends in my life. And I just don't think I would have done that if it wasn't for that letter that my dad wrote me.
Wow. So I had heard bits and pieces and read a bit, but hadn't heard it played out like that. Dude, I can't imagine what it was like as a young man with that precious relationship just expiring effectively in your arms like that. And then like one of the questions I wrote down as you were talking is, was there a faith crisis? And I think what I heard you say is, because of the letter and because of God's grace and moving in that direction, it actually became an opportunity for you to grow rather than to pull back and to really question. I can't imagine what it would have been like to go through that. Even today, you know, I'm 47, I'm not 19. I know the time is coming. I don't know whether I will be there when it happens or I'll get the phone call. I don't know. But even now, I can't imagine what it's going to be like to walk through that.
Well, you know, I was definitely having those thoughts before I got the letter of, is there a God? And even if there is a God, do I want to even follow this God that just allowed my dad to die? I mean, of course I was having those thoughts, like, and I think it's okay to question those things. But then as soon as I got that letter in my hands, it erased all those doubts.
Wow.
And I'm so grateful for it.
Maybe you don't know, but I'm curious, did you ever get a sense from your mom what the inspiration was for the letter?
No, and I've asked my mom, and she doesn't really know. She honestly didn't know. She knew my dad was writing a letter, but she doesn't know what inspired it, and I would love to know. You know, we spent a couple months putting that letter together, and I don't know what my dad gave up to write that letter, what TV show he put aside for a couple months or whatever it was, but man, am I so grateful that my dad took the time to write that letter.
Regular listeners will hear us, will know that we've talked about doing the hard things and investing, leaning in, rethinking what it means to be brave and courageous and strong, you know, to apply those attributes and character qualities to things that really matter. I guarantee that the majority of people, if they knew 2 months from now that their time was going to be up, that the television show, the Facebook feed, the news, it wouldn't get in the way of doing the important things of communicating what people mean to you, investing in important relationships. Who knows what inspired your dad, but the gift that he left you was like the rock in the water that just rippled out from there, right? Like that's the picture I've got in my hand. His life was that ripple, and the letter was the ripple that continues to ripple out.
Well, absolutely, because it completely changed my life direction. I was getting my accounting degree, and I got my accounting degree, but I ended up going into college ministry so that I could try to influence people with the gospel, and you know, for what really matters, and as they think through their life purpose and everything like that. And honestly, that was scary. I had to take some risk at that moment, but I just kept going back to my dad's letter. His voice was still in my head, that as there was hard times to persevere and to live with an eternal perspective. And then that letter, as I've entered in different phases of my life, whether it was graduating college or getting married or having kids, and absolutely all of those phases have been hard because it's like, man, I would have loved to have my dad at my wedding. I would have loved for my wife to get to meet my dad. I would love for my kids to have met my dad. We look at pictures of him, and he's granddad to them.
Yep.
You know, they ask where granddad is. And so, you know, I tell them he's in heaven, but that letter is still guiding me, and it takes on a new meaning with each new phase that I'm in. And so it's pretty neat that even 18 years after my dad's death, my dad, I feel like, is still speaking to me and leading me and guiding and connecting with me. Because as you know, when words are written down, they last. Yeah. We can look at the Bible. It was written several thousand years ago, yep. but because they wrote it down, we still have it and we can still read it.
And words matter. Words have the power to give life and to take life away. And obviously through the letter, your dad breathed life into you, which is fantastic. So at some point, this letter and the impact that it has on you begins to alter the course of your life yet again. And it really becomes your mission, right? Like not just this thing that your dad blessed you with that you can tell others about, but something that gets you up in the morning and puts you to bed at night. What was the moment for you when the letter and what it represented really became your mission?
Well, for the last 18 years, I've been sharing the story of my dad in the letter, and I haven't shied away from sharing it because I know that it does impact people in a good way. And so I've enjoyed sharing it because every time I share it, I get to honor my dad's legacy. But it was once I became a father a couple years ago, 4 years ago, and I began to think about connecting with my children and how am I going to do that? But then a couple years ago, I was listening to a speaker, and this speaker shared a story about how his dad wrote him a letter and how much it impacted him and changed his life. And it just kind of hit me. Mm-hmm. Every child, if they could receive a letter from their father, where their father communicates the things that every person needs to hear from their father, that they're loved, that their father's proud of them, that their father believes in them. Every child needs to hear this. And so I made it a mission to help 1 million fathers write a legacy letter, a well-written, meaningful, lasting letter. I'm not talking about the letter or like, you know, when we buy our wives a Valentine's Day card and we go sit in the car real quick.
And Hallmark does all the writing for us.
Yeah. Like not that kind of letter, like a letter that you really kind of pour your heart and soul into. And so that when you hand it to your child, you can say, hey, I've been working on this for a while.
Yeah.
And even before they read the letter, it's like, wow, like, does my dad love me? Mm-hmm. Like what kind of dad spends a month or so writing a letter to his children? Like a dad who loves his children. Mm-hmm. And so I made it a mission to not only inspire dads to do it, but I realized that it wasn't going to be enough to just inspire them, because I've never met a dad who didn't see the value in writing the letter, but most dads that I've known never actually got the letter done. And I think there's a lot of really good reasons there. I mean, life happens. I think it's also overwhelming to try to write a letter like this, and then you just end up not getting started. And so I created a course that kind of holds dad's hands and helps lead them through the process of writing the letter. And so the value of the course is two things. It actually, we make sure that you actually get the letter written. And then number two, I help dads think through the elements that need to go into the letter to have the maximum impact. I have several friends who have received letters from their fathers over the years, and man, kudos to their dad for taking the time to write this letter, but it just didn't quite have the same impact because the letter was missing some elements that their children really needed to hear from their dad. I have another friend who received a letter from his dad, and his dad was trying to apologize for some things he needed to apologize. And it was, to be quite honest, it was a horrible apology. And my friend couldn't get past that. And so his dad, who knows what the rest of the letter said, because there was this wall there, mm-hmm. because there needed to be a good apology. So I helped dads think through, hey, here's how you apologize and express regrets to your children. But going back to what you were talking about earlier, and just the power of a father's voice, there and words are so important, but there is nothing like the words of a father.
Yep.
Like Mark, I can tell you, hey, good job. Man, this podcast that you're doing is great. It's really impacting lots of people. And you know, that might mean something, but man, if your father tells you that, Mark, I'm so proud of you. Oh my gosh. Like
It's different.
So much more.
Yeah, meaningful. It's different. Yeah. I've said this before that I'm 47 and I still like to hear my dad say, I'm proud of you. Well done. Like, I don't think I'm ever going to grow out of that. And, you know, those are words that I say to my kids on a regular basis, but I'm still a son. And for sure, my human father, and even more so my heavenly father, when I hear those words spoken to me, man, it's incredible. Absolutely incredible.
Well, I 100% agree. I was talking to a man that I met. Actually met this guy in Panera coffee shop a couple years ago, and he was retired. He was in his 60s. He had been the CEO of a company, very successful. He told me the neighborhood he lived in. I'm like, there's some nice houses in there. And so by the world standard, this guy was very successful. And he shares with me, and I don't remember how we got here in this conversation, but he said, man, I feel like I'm still trying to just make my dad proud. Mm. And his dad had died 20 years before.
Wow.
He was still making decisions and living his life trying to make his dad proud because his father never told him that he was proud of him. And so we see this so many times in men that they're just trying to pursue all these different, whether it's their career, you know, but they're trying to pursue success. And this is for women too, you know, so that they can make their dad proud.
Yep.
You know, whatever they think is going to make their dad proud. And they just keep doing. And so what I tell dads is, hey, let's tell our children that we're proud of them so that they don't have to live their life in pursuit of trying to make us proud and pursuing all the wrong things.
Yep.
Let's just tell them right now that we're proud of them and not for what they've done and not for what they've achieved, but we're just proud of them for who they are. Man, you know, I tell dads, you know, it's okay if your kids don't make straight A's. You know, they might make straight C's, and you can be proud of them for the work that they put in to get straight C's. Yeah. And the perseverance that they showed. And those are the things that you can affirm in them.
Oh, you're so right on, man. You're so right on. And it's not easy. But disconnecting your affirmation and your validation and approval and love from performance, mm-hmm. and attaching it just to being is so critical and so powerful. And people will live their entire lives hoping, wishing to hear that validation and approval from their dad. And unfortunately, many never get it. So all the more reason to not leave any doubt in the mind of your child about how you feel about him as a dad, right? Like that's the letter becomes the tool for you to do that. But the big mission is for that child to know that they are loved, that they are valued, that they are appreciated. And boy, when you get that right, or at least get it well, then it opens up the relationship with our Heavenly Father in a much better and open way, right? Like human dads are far from perfect. We say that here too. You don't have to be perfect. You just need to be engaged. You need to be in the mix. But when you can do it well, it opens up a bigger perspective for that deeper spiritual connection to take place between child and Heavenly Father.
Well, and for me, that's what I see our role as fathers is to point our children towards our perfect Heavenly Father. And that's ultimately what got me through that time. Yes, it was the letter and my dad, but what my dad did with that letter was to point me to my Heavenly Father. And my Heavenly Father is what got me through that time and is what is still my North Star to this day. And so we all desperately need a connection with our Heavenly Father. And the research and the data just backs this up, that when the father is connecting with God and when the father is talking to their children about God, it's just more likely. Like it's off the charts of that a person will end up having a relationship with God if their father does.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, Mark, and as I think about fathers and connecting with their children, it is my opinion that it is harder than ever for dads to connect with their children because our children have more voices that are competing with our voice than ever before in history. 100 That's right. years ago, who would my children have to listen to? Me, my wife, maybe close family, maybe the, you know, the people at church, but very few people. Well, now my children literally have the entire world at their fingertips. They can get on their phone. They can get on social media. They can hear everybody's thoughts, anybody that they wanted to. And so the world is literally screaming at our children, yep. hey, come follow me. Come yep. do it this way. Yep. And so it would be really easy as a father to say, to just throw our hands up in the air and say, all right, this is too hard. I'm not going to do it. There's too much competition. But that is absolutely the last thing that we need to be doing. As a father, we need to step up to the plate and we need to hit a home run with our children. They absolutely need us. Even in the moments that it feels like our children don't want to listen to us. And I get that, you know, sometimes as a teenager, you say, Dad, I don't want to listen to you. Or this could be even adult children, but even my two-year-old does this to me. I go into his room to hang out with him and my son, Bo, like runs from me and it's like, Dad, leave me alone. And, you know, it's only two, right? But I will say in that moment, it kind of hurts my flesh a little bit. And mm-hmm. I want to say, okay, fine. All right. You know, if you don't want me, then I'll leave. But I know that he needs me to pursue him, that even when he turns his back on me, he still needs me to pursue him. And so my example for this, an example for all of us is, what did God do for us? Because for me, I know I turn my back on God all the time with my actions. There's times I should be praying to God, thanking God, but I don't. And I'm just like, I'll just do it myself. And in effect, I'm turning my back on God. But what does God do? Man, he still pursues me. That's he still right. pursues us.
That's right.
No matter what we do. And so as fathers, that's our ultimate example of a father. And I love the story of the prodigal son. And I, you know, growing up, I always, when I read the story, I resonated with the son, right? But now that I'm a father, I'm looking closer at exactly what that father did. And that father runs towards his son and throws his arms around him, kisses him, and welcomes him. His father was pursuing him. And so, in my opinion, this is what we have to do right now. We can't let all the distractions of the world, whether it's our phone, like we get distracted from connecting with our children. For me personally, I know I come home from work and I absolutely want to connect with my children, but then my phone rings or yeah. I think, oh, I'm just going to look up something real quick. Yeah. The next thing you know, I'm on my phone for like I'm 10 or 15 minutes. And so Mark, I'm not even embarrassed to admit this, especially after I saw Social Dilemma on Netflix, where they're purposely trying to get me addicted. I had to start putting my phone in my car, in my truck, in the garage, and turning it off when I'm wanting to be present with my family. And that's what I had to do for it to not even be a distraction. So I think it's highly appropriate for us to do things like that to try to connect with our children. And ultimately, I think that's what the writing a letter to your children does. It is a way of, as we said, expressing to our children what they need to hear. But when you write a letter and their children read it, it just puts your voice in the back of their head. And there's no stronger voice that I want in my children's head than my voice.
That's right.
When they're making decisions, you know, whatever the decision that might be, I want my voice to be there. And so the great thing with the letter is you can just go back and keep reading the letter
right
over
there.
And over and over again.
Yeah. So true. So true. So good. So I know there's someone in our audience that this episode was intended for and will want to connect with you. So how can that person follow up, go a little bit deeper into this process and connect with their kids in the way that they want to?
Yeah, anyone can go to legacyletterchallenge.com and they can read more about my story and exactly how we help dads write the letter and can sign up to write a letter. We try to make this 4-week course affordable for everyone. Obviously, if anyone ever has an issue and can't afford it, man, just email us because we'll give you a scholarship, no questions asked. I just want to help dads write letters to their children. So legacyletterchallenge.com. Every month I'm taking a new round of dads through the course and helping them write their letter.
Oh, that's great, man. So his name is Blake Brewer. The website is legacyletterchallenge.com. Blake, thank you for sharing your story, not just with us. I mean, you're blessing our audience today, but for having the courage to share your story and to step out and embrace the mission that God has for you, even in the midst of a horrible tragedy that you had to endure. Thank you for the courage, for your willingness to step into this space of encouraging dads to connect more deeply to their kids, because as you well know, it's important work. It is so very much needed today, and I know you're making an impact. So thank you.
I appreciate it, Mark.
Hey, listeners, thanks for journeying with us on this Next Man Up podcast. You know, we would love to hear from you. Maybe you have a question or an idea, perhaps a topic for us to consider. If that's you and you want to reach out to us, you can get us at feedback@thenextmanup.com. That's feedback@thenextmanup.com. Again, we'd love to hear from you. Until next time, we'll see you later.